field of rational numbers.
Hmm.
So, like, but R is a set of real numbers, which is scalars, or Q are a set of rational numbers.
Hmm.
And C is a set of complex numbers, so these are scalars. So, this can be treated as vectors. So, I'm confused about scalars and vectors.
Okay. So, I will make some comment about it.
Okay, sir.
So, you can see the screen, right?
Yes, sir.
So, we will start. So, today I will try to discuss we have talked about the basics on the day, and we have state space of a quantum system. So let's start with the quantum system. Quantum system. And it has got a state space. State space, which is a Hilbert space. So I will denote it as H. And then we have states are kind of kets, which are usually denoted by this kind of symbol, and properties are self-adjoint operators. Okay, so this is the kind of structure that we have. Now, we have said that if A is an operator, representing an observable, then of course it is a linear Hermitian operator, linear self-adjoint. Linear and self-adjoint. Now, you can think of having a set of eigenfunctions or eigenstates with the eigenvalue a1 phi. Okay. So here this set phi n is eigenstates of A, and this set of values an, they are eigenvalues. Now we have discussed that this phi m, this eigenstates of A, form a complete orthonormal basis of H is vector space, and this forms a complete orthonormal basis of X. Now, what does this mean? This means that any arbitrary state I in H can be expressed as I is equal to sum over n dn by n. Okay, and where these coefficients of expansion can be obtained by taking an inner product of psi now. I want to make the following statement. For any vector space, okay, for any vector space basis is not unique. This we know. There can be infinitely many bases. However, we can say that basis of H and eigenstates of A. Now these two properties, that is basis of H and eigenstates of A, these two properties have to be together for some set of states. Okay, so for example, as I said that this particular set phi n qualifies that it is eigenstates of A and that also is a basis of H. Okay, so I can write, I am trying to develop a language to call this. So I say that it is A's eigen basis of H. Okay, I'm going to use this notation. That means I'm going to call it eigenbasis. Whose eigenbasis? It is A's eigenbasis. Okay, it is A's eigenstates and it is a basis of H. Okay, so please understand, whenever I write like this, it means these two properties are there. Now, is there a set, this phi n is an A's eigenbasis. Now, is that unique? That means, can I say that there is only one particular set which is eigenstates of A as well as basis of H? Okay. So, the question that I am asking is A's eigenbasis of H unique? Now, it turns out that the answer is yes. Answer is yes. If this set of eigenvalues, this AN, are non-degenerate, that means all of them are distinct. If they are all distinct, then the A's eigenbasis of H is unique. Now, there is another question now that comes. If the eigenvalues have degeneracy, then this answer means that it is not unique. Then, how do we deal with such situations?
And how do you deal with bringing uniqueness back to the problem? So we have to ask a question, how to deal with this degeneracy? Okay. So if A and R degenerate, then it is not unique. So it is not unique if any of the eigenvalues of A are degenerate. Okay, so let us look at some simple example. You know that, let us consider a toy example. Okay, so consider a simple example. Of a finite dimensional space. In particular, I will say three dimensions. So let us say that, consider an operator, because in three-dimensional space, operators can be written as matrices. Consider an operator A, just like these elements, 0, AA, 0, minus A, 0, 0, 0, minus A. So what are the eigenvalues of A? Eigenvalues of A are A and minus A. So there are two eigenvalues which are same. So that means we can say this eigenvalue minus A is doubly degenerate. Now, we can ask a question that what are the eigenvectors? I have chosen the simplest matrix. So the eigenvectors are 1, 0, 0 for A, this eigenvalue A. 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0, 1 for minus. That means there are two eigenvectors for the same eigenvalue. Okay. So that is what we call degeneracy, right? So A 1, 0, 0 is small a 1, 0, 0. And A 0, 1, 0 is minus A 0, 1, 0. And A 0, 0, 1 is equal to minus A 0, 0. So then you have, this set of vectors, namely 1, 0, 0.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, 0, 1, here. 0.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, here for eigenvectors minus A, we have two, eigenvalue minus A, we have two eigenvectors 0, 1, 0 and 0, 0, 1. These two are for linearly independent. It always means for if means can we have two for a degenerate eigenvalue linear means eigenvectors can be linear dependent, is it
possible? No. See, these eigenvectors these are actually orthogonal, which means they are definitely linearly independent. So eigenvalues are same. That means you can have, in fact, if you have only two linearly independent eigenvectors with the same eigenvalue, then we can say that there is a degeneracy. So linear independence is necessary.
Can you repeat, sir? Can you repeat? I could not.
What I'm saying is, if eigenvalue is same and eigenvectors are linearly independent, only then we can say there is a degeneracy. Correct. So the eigenvectors corresponding to same eigenvalues are linearly independent. Only then we can say that there is a degeneracy.
Then why don't they span the space?
They span the space. That's what I'm saying. So this particular, so this is a basis. This is a basis of this three-dimensional space. Okay, let me call that as H itself. Okay, this is basis of H. There's no doubt about this. But the question, the important question is that is this is this unique? What do I mean by unique? Is this a unique ace eigenbasis of H? Okay, so that is the question that I am asking. So you can see that the answer is no. Okay, so the answer is no. Why the answer is no? Answer is no. It is because minus A is degenerate. So I will show you why this answer is no. For example, you consider these three vectors, another set. Okay. So first one is 1, 0, 0. Now second one, let's call this as 0, y and z. With the factor of 1 by square root of y square plus z square. This is just normalization. And you can have next one as 0, let me call this as minus z and y. A normalization factor square root of y square plus this. So you can understand this very easily. So I can choose any value for y and z. Now tell me what is A acting on this fact, this one, that is 0, y, z. What is A acting on this? Into, of course, 1 by square root of y square plus z square. That is equal to minus A into 0 y z. Is that correct? Y square plus this. Correct? Because you have A here, you operate. So this one is going to be 0. This one gives you minus A into Y. And this one is going to give you minus A into Z. So I can pull out a minus A. And then this is, so this is an eigenvector of A with the same thing called minus. Now what happens if I take the other, so what happens if I use the next vector? Suppose I choose A acting on 0 minus Z Y, 1 by square root of Y square plus Z square. So you can see that it is minus A into minus Z, so I can pull out minus A, and then this will be 0 minus Z Y into 1 by square root of Y square plus Z square. And notice that this is a vector with the eigenvalue A, this is a vector with the eigenvalue minus A, this is a vector with eigenvalue minus A. And all these three vectors are orthogonal to each other, because you take dot product of this with this, this is minus YZ, this is plus ZY, it will be 0. Okay, so now you can see that I have constructed infinitely many bases, because for every value of Y and Z, I have a basis, correct? So, this set 1, 0, 0, 1 by square root of Y square plus Z square, 0, Y, Z, comma 1 by square root of Y square plus Z square, 0 minus Z Y. Okay, this set is also A's eigenbasis, A's eigenbasis of H for any Y comma Z. That means what? It is not unique. There are infinitely many A's eigen basis of it. Okay. Suppose if I take one basis, which I think you probably are familiar. If suppose you take Y equal to 1, Z equal to 1. This is 1 by root 2, 0, 1, 1, 1 by root 2, minus 1, 0, minus 1, 1, or 1, minus 1, it doesn't matter. So, so you can see for any choice of Y, for every choice of Y and Z, you have a basis. And that is an A's eigenbasis with the same eigenvalues, just like 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0. So, there is this non-uniqueness. Okay. So, now one can ask the question, is there something that we can do so that some basis of A and A's eigenbasis of H, we can find a unique basis. Okay. So, that is where we have to ask the following question. What actually means, what do you mean by this degeneracy? It is because of the degeneracy that we understand, right? It is because of the degeneracy we are able to find infinitely many sets which can become eigenstates of A as well as basis of H. Okay. Now, so if So you can understand this one. If there is a degeneracy, if there is a degeneracy, for any of the eigenvalues of A, then one thing is guaranteed, then there exists another operator that commutes with A. Okay, then there exists another operator that commutes with A. Now let's try to understand this one. Suppose, let's say that you have your A, as we had written earlier, is A 0, 0, 0 minus A 0, 0, 0 minus A. Is that correct? Now, since there is a degeneracy in this particular case, okay, so let us try to view this matrix like this, as a block like this. So if I pull out minus A from this block, the lower block, it is like identity. Okay. Now suppose if you consider another matrix B, okay, which is some B 0, 0, and there is some matrix here. I do not know what is there, but there is some 2 by 2 matrix here, some black. Okay, so this is some 2 by 2 matrix. Now, whatever is the 2 by 2 matrix here, this commutes with A. I don't know if it is easy to see for you. So, A, B, minus B, A is equal to 0. Okay. If B has this block diagonal structure. If B has this block diagonal structure. Now, what goes into this 2 by 2 matrix? It doesn't matter actually. Okay. So, if you want to understand this, let us put some, let's say I put some alpha, beta, some gamma, delta, something like this. Now you try to ask what is AB. AB is equal to A 0, 0, 0 minus A 0, 0, 0 minus A. Into you have B 0, 0, 0 alpha, beta, and 0 gamma, delta. So that is equal to, you have AB and 0, 0, and you have minus, okay, first one is 0, second one is minus A alpha, and the last one is minus A beta. And this is 0, minus A gamma minus A delta. Now you ask what is VA, that is equal to, first you write down V 0, 0, 0 alpha beta, 0 gamma delta into A 0, 0, 0 minus A 0, 0, 0 minus A. So that is equal to AB 0, 0. And this will be 0, 0, so minus alpha A, minus alpha beta, sorry, minus A beta, okay. And then minus A gamma. So you can see that this AB minus BA is C. Now, alpha, beta, gamma, delta are arbitrary. I did not put any values there. So, the moment you have a degeneracy, that means when there is... So, you see, I have chosen this matrix in a diagonal form, this matrix A in a diagonal form for simplicity. But even if I have some matrix in some arbitrary form, I can always diagonalize that. When I diagonalize that, along the diagonal, you will have eigenvalues. Okay? So we can always bring it to the diagonal form, and hence there is no loss of generality in considering it in the diagonal form. Okay. So we have chosen this. So let me choose. Choose B to be also as simple as possible. So let's call this.
Sir, you say B here is block diagonal. What do you mean by that? B is block diagonal.
It is block diagonal because I have like a 1x1 block here and a 2x2 block here along the diagonal. Okay, so this is 1x1 block. And this is 2x2 block. That makes a 3x3 matrix. Suppose if I have n x n matrix, then along the diagonal, I'll have these blocks.
Okay, sir. Okay.
So let me take this matrix to be kind of a simple. So let us call this as 0B and 0B0. So let me choose this because it is true for anything. So I am choosing this block matrix like this. Okay. Now we can ask a question that notice that. This matrix B is a matrix representation. You know, if you want to write down any matrix representation of an operator, you have to choose a basis. Matrix representation of operator B in which basis? In the basis 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, and 0, 0. This was the first original basis that we have started with, right? So in this basis it is, but note that 100 is also an eigenstate eigenstate of B. Okay, so it is not very difficult to see what happens when B acting on 1, 0, 0. You will get B 1, 0. With the eigenvalue, Okay, so that is easy to see, but 0 1 0 and 0 0 1 are not eigenstates of B. Okay, so that is something which you can verify, because when B is acting on 0, 1, 0, it will become 0, 0, 1. Okay, so this vector will be transformed to this vector, and this vector will be transformed to this vector. Okay, so now I think there is a lesson that we have to learn here. When I am seeing many times, the students will have this misunderstanding. The lesson is that if A comma B, if two operators commute, okay, if two operators commute, not every eigenvector of A is an eigenvector of B. Okay, so the counter example is right here, because 0, 1, 0 and 0, 0, 1 are eigenvectors of A, but they are not eigenvectors of B. So if A and B are commuting, it does not mean that every eigenvector of A is an eigenvector. Okay? But...
Sir?
Yeah.
So we can exchange the rows, row 2 and row 3. Uh-huh. Then we get the same matrix, no? The row operations are the equivalent. Like we get the same matrix.
I am choosing this particular arrangement only for simple calculation. Okay, I could have chosen some alpha, beta, gamma, delta, like in the previous case, where such row operations will not produce an equivalent matrix. Correct. So, I am just choosing this for a simple demonstration. Okay, so you can ask a question that what is guaranteed is that we can find a basis of H whose vectors are common eigenvectors of both A and B. Okay, now this is guaranteed. This is guaranteed if A, B commute. Okay, so please understand that not every eigenvector of A is an eigenvector of B. Similarly, not every eigenvector of B is an eigenvector of A. But what is guaranteed is that we can find a basis of H which is a common eigenvectors of both in. Okay, so let's look at now. If you look at this, we had infinitely many bases here, right? So from these infinitely many, we have to pick up one set, which is an eigenvector of B also. Okay, so for that, what you have to do? It is very simple. Now you look at how to find that one. Now we can work with some subspace. Okay. So we have B. Remember, our B is B 0 0, 0 0 B, and 0 B 0. So we try to look this as a block form. So there is no problem with respect to this 1 by 1 matrix because this is already a diagonal. So off diagonal thing is this 2 by 2 matrix. Correct? So let us look at that sub matrix. So consider this matrix. There is 0, B, B, D. Okay. So what are the eigenvalues of this matrix? Eigenvalues are plus minus B. Okay, that is lambda square minus b square is equal to 0. So it is plus minus. And remember, this is actually b times 0, 1, 1, 0. Right? This is Pauli x sigma x matrix. So this has plus minus 1 as eigenvalue. So the eigenvalues of this one are plus minus 2. And now eigenvectors. So let's say we want to find out eigenvectors. Eigenvector of 0. I can find out eigenvector of 0, 1, 1, 0 because that is what is the normalized eigenvector that we will get. Okay, for eigenvalue plus 1. For example, I want to find that out. Okay, so let me just find that out. That means I have 0, 1, 1, 0 acting on, let's say, some vector all x, comma y is equal to plus 1 into x, comma y. Okay, so this simply gives you an equation y equal to x. So that means your x comma y can be written as x comma x. Okay. So if you normalize, so normalized vector is what will be the eigenvector, is simply 1 by root 2 times 1, 1. Okay. Similarly, for eigenvalue minus 1, we get 1 by root 2 into 1 minus 1 or minus 1, 1 as eigenvector. So this tells me that these eigenvectors, are 1 by root 2 times, the first one is always, because we have looked at only subspace, that is 1, 1 in the yz position,
and 1 by root 2 times 0 minus 1, 1. Okay. These are orthogonal eigenvectors of B. Now, this also forms a basis for this. Now, are these eigenvectors of A also? Yes. Okay. These are eigenvectors of A also for the choice of y equal to z equal to 1. Correct? Among the infinitely many things that we have written, if you take y equal to z equal to 1, this is also a basis of A. So, if I choose this set, okay, so this set, is a common eigenbasis of I think I should not write like this. It should be a common eigenstates. Maybe I should write states of A and B. Okay. And is a basis of it. Now, how do I write it like in the previous language? So I can say that this is so I will write A comma B is common eigenbasis of H. So let me write it like this. Usually it is difficult to find appropriate language, but let me write it like this. It is A B is common eigenbasis of H. Now, we can ask the question, is this unique? Okay. Is this unique? Okay. Now let's find out if this is unique or not. How do we find out? So we have to ask a question. Now let's say I take, let's make this table. I take an eigenvector. Okay, so this is basically common eigenvector. Common eigenvector, then A's eigenvalue, and then B's eigenvalue. Okay. So let us try to look at this one. So first, let's look at 1, 0, 0. So A's eigenvalue is A, and B's eigenvalue is B. Right? Then my second eigenvector is 1 by root 2, 0, 1, 1. A's eigenvalue is minus A and B's eigenvalue is B. And third eigenvector is 1 by root 2 into 0, 1, of 0 minus 1, 1 as we have written. And this is minus A and this is. Now you look at this set. Okay, so look at the pairs of the eigenvalues. Okay, so for example, I have A comma B and minus A comma B and minus A comma minus. Okay. Now, look at these things. These are distinct sets. Okay. Distinct sets.
Okay, if for example this is AB and one more set is also AB, then that means there is still some degeneracy at the level of two operators itself. Okay, these are distinct sets. When they are distinct sets, now you can say as a set of operators, that implies there is no degeneracy with respect to the set of operators A comma P. Okay. Now there is no degeneracy. This implies, so A is common eigenbasis of H is unique. If there is no degeneracy with respect to this set, then it is unique. If the sets are not distinct, that means there is still degeneracy with respect to the set A comma. So that implies A, B is common eigenbasis of H is not unique, just like in the previous case, it's not unique. Now what happens? It's not very difficult to guess. So in that case, in such case, there exists another operator you can call it as C, such that it commutes with A and it also commutes with B. Okay, with those two operators it will commute. Then you can find we can find a common eigenstates of A comma B comma C, and examine if A comma B comma C's eigenbasis of H is unique. When it will be unique? Again, you look at the set of eigenvalues of A, B, C for each of the eigenstates, common eigenstates, and see if they are distinct sets. If they are not distinct, then you repeat. There will be another operator B, which will be commuting with A, B, C, and look at common eigenstates of A, B, C, D, and proceed like this. So you proceed in this way until you find a set of operators A, comma B, comma C, comma D, etc. Some set of operators which commute among themselves. Okay, so these are set of mutually commuting observables. Observables such that their common eigenbasis of H is unique. That means they have distinct sets of eigenvalues. Okay, so you proceed till you get this uniqueness. Okay, once you get this uniqueness, this set, okay, so in such a situation, the set is A, comma B, comma C, D, etc. Some more are there. They are there. The set is called a complete set of compatible observables. Complete set of compatible observables. Okay. So generally in quantum mechanics textbooks, they write this as CSCO. It means it is a complete set of compatible observables.
This set is exhaustive. This set is exhaustive, means we cannot find another operator.
So you're asking whether this set is unique.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this set is, it's a good question. This set is not unique. As I told you right in the beginning, that I have chosen a particular B, but you could have chosen infinitely many such Bs. What is guaranteed for B is only the block diagonal structure. But actual matrix can be anything. So this set A, comma B, comma C is not okay, but what is unique is the cardinality of this set is unique in the sense, so you may have a different set, but the number of operators in CSCO is unique. So if you have four operators, then you will have some, because number of operators is related to the degeneracy structure. Once you have degeneracy structure fixed, then the number of operators are. So instead of finding A, B, C, D, you can find a G, H, F, I, something like that. You can find a different set. So this is the concept of complete set of compatible observables, and so this is the key idea. I have actually tried to communicate the key idea, and once you understand the key idea, then now I want to mention certain auxiliary concepts that are related to this. are there some questions about this, about the key idea that we have discussed so far?
So can you give us an example for such a set of operators?
I'm going to do that.
Okay, sir.
I'm going to do that. Any question on the thing that is discussed so far?
So you have mentioned the state space is a Hilbert space. Can we say that it is a separable Hilbert space because the energy eigenfunctions are denominable? But if we choose another basis, like if we choose position basis, then it's not denominable. So is it a separable Hilbert space or not?
If there exists any denumerable complete orthonormal basis, then the Hilbert space is called separable. Okay, position basis is a continuous basis, non-denumerable basis, but all the Hilbert spaces that we deem in quantum mechanics, they are separable Hilbert spaces. And what example I have chosen here is a very simple example. This is even a finite dimensional vector space.
But sir, like if phi or psi is like a state vector, which can be represented in any of the bases, like in position basis or in like momentum basis or energy basis, eigenfunctions. So like in energy eigenfunctions, the orthonormal basis is denumerable, so it's separable. Hilbert space. If we represent in that basis, but if we represent it in position basis, then it will become not separable.
Now, what I am trying to say is, separability is not a property of the basis. It is the property of the Hilbert space. Do you agree?
Sir, like if the state has orthonormal state is complete orthonormal space, it is denominable. Then
it's not like that. What I'm trying to say is separability is the property of the Hilbert space. Now Hilbert space is a vector space. It can have many different bases. Like we have said, every eigenstates of self-adjoint operator is a basis. Now you can have the basis can be denumerable, basis can be non-denumerable, like position basis, momentum basis is a continuous basis. But separability of the Hilbert space as a definition is the property that if it has any denumerable basis, then it is called separable. And most of our Hilbert spaces that we are going to deal in quantum mechanics, because of quantization, there are denumerable bases for almost all, except position and momentum, almost all the operators that we deal with, they will have denumerable spaces. So all these spaces are separable spaces.
Okay, sir, if a Hilbert space has denumerable basis, it might have non-denumerable basis, but if it has denumerable basis, then it's a separable Hilbert space.
Correct.
Okay, sir. It's clear, sir. Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
What you have said here is like, if it is not denumerable, we will stop this process of finding common eigen operator. Else, if it is degenerate, we have to carry eigen operator. That is what you meant here.
Correct. So you have to go on finding commuting operators. Still, we get as a set, we get distinct set of eigenvalues. If the set has some degeneracy, then you once again have to look for a new operator, which there exists, that is guaranteed. You have to look for it, of course. Existence is guaranteed. Construction, you have to do it. And one of the ways that I said is the construction is by understanding this block diagram.
Okay, sir. Sir, can you please tell something about the degeneracy?
Yeah. So let's look at some examples. Then probably it will become clear. Let's say that before we look at some example, let me just tell you that let us say that I have this is a kind of operator. I'm just cooking up an operator. So consider consider an operator. Which is let's say a 10 by 10 matrix. Okay, it's a 10 by 10 matrix. And this matrix, I'm not going to write this matrix, but this matrix has the following eigenvalues. So let's say call it A. Now let's say that A1 is non-degenerate. This is one eigenvalue. Okay. Then A2 is let's say threefold degenerate. Threefold degenerate. And A3 is twofold degenerate, that means doubly degenerate. Okay. So that means there's 1, 3, 4 plus 2, 6. And let's say A4 is fourfold degenerate. Let's assume this kind of thing. That means what? That means we have there is one eigenvector. For A1. And here there are three eigenvectors. For A. And there are two eigenvectors. For A. And there are four eigenvectors for A. So there are only four distinct eigenvalues, but there are 10 eigenvectors. Correct. So in diagonal form, if I have to write this in the diagonal form, so I can say A1 and then 0, 0, 0, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And then I have 0, A2, then these are all zeros. And 0, 0, A2, then all these are zeros. 0, 0, 0, A2, again all zeros. So you can see that A2 is occurring three times. That is why it is threefold degenerate. Then I have 0, 0, 0, 0, A3, and 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, A3, and 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay, A2 is twofold degenerate, and then I have next one 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, A4,
0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 0 and 0 0 0 0 maybe I should have taken a smaller number 4 and lastly on zeros. Okay. So this is my A in the diagonal form.
Now I have this much degeneracy, right? So like what are the eigenvectors? Eigenvectors corresponding to A1 is 1, all 9 zeros. For the corresponding to A2 is 0, 1, all zeros, 0, 0, 1, all zeros, like that. These are, this is what is called the trivial basis of this 10-dimensional space. Okay, so that is fine. So you can see that there is a basis. Now, since there is a degeneracy, what is guaranteed is that there exists a operator B such that this operator A and this operator B come. Okay, so in the trivial, so what is the so what is the block diagonal form? Block diagonal form so this is the question that we are asking. So what is the block diagonal form of B? Okay, so I think it is if you have understood whatever we have discussed, so it should not be very difficult for you to realize this is your B and you have 1x1 matrix here. Okay, so then there are all zeros here and there are zeros here. What should be the next block? Next block is a 3x3 block because A2 is threefold degenerate and there are zeros here and there are zeros here. And next block is a 2x2 block. Okay, so there are zeros here and there are zeros here. And then lastly, you have a 4x4 block. Okay, so this is what I meant by a block diagonal form. Now the size of this block is determined by the degeneracy of the eigenvalue of A. Okay, so if I have first, as you can see that the way I have given, the first one is non-degenerate, that means there is only one eigenvector. So there will be a 1x1 block. Then this will be a 3x3 block. A block. And then you have a 2x2 block. And then you have a 4x4 block. Okay. So that is these blocks are in B such that
A comma B. Okay. So this is this is also a mathematical example, but I just wanted to tell you that if you consider this block form, it looks like this. Now let me give you a physical example. Let's look at a physical example. So consider a two-dimensional harmonic oscillator. Okay, I'm going to borrow some results from your quantum mechanics. If you have not done this, then some of you may not. But anyway, it's not very difficult to understand what I'm saying. So two-dimensional harmonic oscillator, you have Hamiltonian, depends on a state defined by two quantum numbers, n1 comma n2, such that the eigenvalue is given by h bar omega into n1 plus n2 plus 1. This is the eigenvalue into n1 comma n2. So these are the eigenvalues of two-dimensional harmonic oscillator. Now, so let us look at the states. Let's say this is my state n1 comma n2, and then the energy h bar omega into n1 plus n2 plus 1 is the energy. So suppose if you take ground state corresponding to 0 comma 0, and this has an energy of h bar omega. Now you take a state 1 comma 0, or you take a state 0 comma 1. Now these two states will have same energy, namely 2 times h cross omega. That means this energy is two-fold degenerate. Two-fold degenerate. That means there are two states corresponding to this one. Now when you go to 2 comma 0 or 1 comma 1 or 0 comma 2, these three states will have 3 h cross omega. So this energy is threefold degenerate. This energy is threefold degenerate. Now, if you can see that 2 plus 0 is 2, 1 plus 1 is 2. So if you define some n as n1 plus n2 and define en as n plus 1 into h cross omega, then notice, then you can see that en is n plus 1 fold degenerate. Now this is an infinite dimensional matrix. That means infinite dimensional space. Okay, so note that the h here is infinite dimensional. Now suppose you want to write, you want to represent. Okay, so suppose you want to represent the Hamiltonian operator. This is Hamiltonian operator
as a matrix, which will be infinite by infinite matrix anyway, in this basis, that is n1 comma n2 basis. N1 comma n2 basis. So if you represent this one, what kind of a matrix will you get? So you will have, let's say you have your Hamiltonian like this. Okay, so your H matrix will be, you have H bar omega and then all zeros. Then you have 2 H bar omega, all zeros. Again 2 H bar omega because it is doubly degenerate, all zeros. 3 H bar omega, all zeros. 3 H bar omega, all zeros. 3 H bar omega, all zeros. Okay, so this is going to be, there are infinite number of rows, infinite number of columns like that. And because you see, this is two-fold degenerate, I write two times, this is three-fold degenerate, I write two times. Next one is four-fold degenerate, next one is five-fold degenerate, and this goes on and on. And this is infinite by infinite matrix. Okay, now as we have degeneracy here, we can say that there exists an operator that commutes with the Hamiltonian. Okay, so there exists an operator that commutes with Hamiltonian. Now, what is that operator that commutes with the Hamiltonian? Whatever is that operator, okay, so call it something. Okay, whatever is that operator, now matrix representation,
sir, this existence of P guaranteed once H has degenerate eigenvalue, is it correct?
Yes.
If H has non-degenerate eigenvalue, in that case?
In that case, the only operator that commutes with H is the identity.
So, we cannot find any operator.
Correct.
So, the converse of this statement is also true.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
So, matrix representation of P in this basis, that is N1 comma N2 basis. Okay, in this basis, the matrix representation of B, I don't know yet what is this B, but whatever is that, the B should have this kind of a structure. What is the structure? You have a 1x1 block, then it is 0 everywhere, then you have a 2x2 block, and then 0 everywhere, and then you have a 3x3 block, and then 0 everywhere, 4x4 block, like this. So it is going to be like this. Okay, now this statement I can make without bothering about the physics. Okay, but if you want to understand from physics, you can find out what this means. It turns out that if you have your Hamiltonian is going to be equal to px square plus py square by 2m plus half m omega square into x square plus y square. This is two-dimensional isotropic harmonic oscillator. It's called isotropic because omega is same for both x and y. Okay, so now physically, if you can think of an operator called LZ, which is equal to x x times py minus y times px. Okay, you can show that LZ commutes with H. Okay, so the representation of this LZ in the energy basis will look like this. And then one can think of writing a common eigenstates of H and LZ. Okay, so basically this N1 and 2, this basis itself is, if you can write down Hx, okay, which is Px square by 2m plus half m omega square x square, and Hy is Hy as Py square by 2m plus half m omega square y square. Okay, and you can show that these two commute. Okay, Hx and Hy commute is equal to 0. And this is essentially a common eigen basis of these two operators, Hx and Hy. Okay, so you can also talk about, but this common eigen basis itself is not unique because there is still degeneracy in that. And hence, there is another operator which commutes with both of them. So that is the nature. So this is a physical example.
Sir?
Yeah.
So what about parity operator? Because here the potential is even. So it will have different parity. So parity operator should also commute with the Hamiltonian.
Parity operator commutes with the Hamiltonian, but parity operator is a discrete operator. Okay, it is a discrete operator. That will be just a 2x2 matrix. So such discrete operators are not, when I say there exists an operator, that operator will have same size as the operator that we are considering.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So this is another example. Now let us see some importance of this one. For example, let's take I will just mention a couple of incidents where this is a very much useful. For example, consider a hydrogen atom. Suppose when we are trying to solve quantum mechanics of hydrogen atom, okay, so we look for...
So in one dimension, there is no, as there is no degeneracy, this will not be there, sir. Means one operator will always commute with identity only identity, or...
Yes. In one dimension, there is no degeneracy, no?
Yes, sir.
So there is no other... you don't have any other operator that will communicate this.
Okay, sir. Okay.
So when we are talking about hydrogen atom, we look for common eigenstates. Of Hamiltonian, L square, and L is it. Right? So these three operators, of course, I'm not going to consider spin, okay, without spin. So these three operators will form what is called CSU. Okay, so that is why we look for common eigenstates of these three operators. And the stationary states of hydrogen atom
are given by these three quantum numbers, N, L, and M. These three quantum numbers. So N is associated with the eigenvalue of H, L is associated with the eigenvalue of L square, and M is associated with the eigenvalue of L square. So this is one example. The second example is when we are talking about addition of angular momentum. Addition of angular momentum. When we are talking about addition of angular momentum. So let's say that you have some total angular momentum J, which is sum of vector sum of two angular momentum J1 plus J2. And normally, when you study angular momentum, that is for angular momentum. We have common eigenstates of J square and K, because this they to commute, and this. So this set J square comma JZ is SESC. Now for this case, so for the composite case of two angular momenta, we have J1 square comma J2 square comma J1Z comma J2Z as CSC. Okay. Now, correspondingly, for 2J1 plus 1 into 2J2 plus 2 plus 1 dimensional inverse space, we have a basis. We have a basis given by J1, comma J2, comma M1, comma M. Okay, so this is this is CSCO's common eigenbasis. The Hilbert space. But you know that you can have we can also have J1 square, J2 square, J square, and JZ, where J is the total angular momentum, as another CSC. And
these particular states J1, comma J2, comma J, comma capital M, okay, is this CSCO common eigenvalue. Now one can think of writing this. For example, I have J1, comma J2, comma J, comma M. I can express this vector in terms of the CSU of the previous, the basis of the previous CSU. That can be written as, so there will be some coefficient which will depend on J1 prime, J2 prime, M1, comma M2. Maybe I can write M1 prime, M2 prime. And of course, these coefficients will depend on J1, J2, JM, and J1 prime, J2 prime, M1 prime, M2 prime. Okay. So I can express this an element of one basis can be expressed in terms of elements of the other basis. And these coefficients are called the Clebsch-Jordan coefficients. These are very important in spectroscopy and very important in atomic physics. So you can see that the importance of CSCO is I have illustrated in two cases. One is in hydrogen atom, where we choose to work with the CSCO called Hamiltonian L-square and Lissett. And here you have in the angular momentum addition, we work with two CSCOs, and then one CSCO basis elements can be expressed in terms of the other CSCO spaces using Clebsch-Jordan coefficients. Anyway, we will discuss about this in more detail later, but I'm just giving here as an application of this. I mean, where is it used? That is the important.
Sir, when we talk about commutators, does that mean we have some symmetry, some invariance in the system? Does that mean we have some symmetry invariance in the system? When we talk about commutator being zero?
Yes, yes. There is a connection between that is. Let's say that I have A, comma B is commutator of A, comma B is equal to B. Okay, so that means this implies AB is equal to B. Correct? AB is equal to B. Or I can write this as, so post multiply with B inverse. Then I have A is equal to B A B inverse. Okay. So, if this means what? There is some kind of I could have also written a more familiar thing is A is equal to B inverse A B. You may be recalling that this is like similarity transformation in matrices. So, that means it is like there is a transformation called B which leaves A invariant. Okay, so that means there is some transformation. So some transformation. Transformation that rules B and A. Sorry, that leaves some transformation called B that leaves A in A. That's what this means. A is equal to B inverse AB means this is the transformation. And that makes this A itself. That means A is invariant of such transformation. Now, what happens if it is so? It is so, then it is like, suppose let's say that let us say that A on some psi is equal to A psi. That means psi is an eigenvector of A. Okay, psi is an eigenvector, of A with eigenvalue A. Now we can ask a question, what is B psi? I don't know what is B psi, but I can say that it will be some other, this is the most general thing, no? This B will take psi to some phi. Okay, now we can ask a question, what is B psi is equal to phi? And what can we say about this? So for that, let us try to operate, examine what happens if A is acting on phi. When A is acting on phi, you know A is like B into psi, correct? But you know, since AB is equal to BA, because A and B are commuting with each other, AB is equal to BA, I can write this as BA acting on psi. But I already know what is A acting on psi because psi is an eigenstate of. So it is A, B acting on psi, which is nothing but A times phi. So what did I observe is that phi, okay, so the result is phi is also an eigenstate of A, and more importantly, with the same eigenvalue A. That means what? I have two states, psi and phi, with the same eigenvalue A. That means there is a degeneracy. Okay. So what I tried to explain here is the connection between the invariance, commutation, and the degeneracy. So if you say that you have some invariance, then there will be an operator which commutes with the original operator, and then there is a degeneracy associated with it. So the reverse is also true. If you have degeneracy, then there is some operator that commutes with that operator, and then there is an invariance associated with that. So this is a very strong connection.
Sir, when you talk about inverse, and when you wrote down A equals to B inverse AB, it seemed like normal subgroup. Is there a connection? Like an invariant subgroup, subgroup,
or
normal subgroup.
Yeah. So here I'm just trying to argue with respect to one operator. But normally, when you say that you have a transformation here, okay, in quantum mechanics, these transformations are unitary transformations, and then these unitary transformations, if you consider set of all such unitary transformations, that will form a group. Okay, so we can say there is a group of transformations. Okay, so it has connections to group theory, but maybe we will discuss more about it later. The group theory connections are also important.
Sir, because I was reading Afkin, and there is like there's an example of hydrogen atom problem which has rotational symmetry. So it is written H R equals to R H. Because R operates on H, that commutes with H. Correct. So that forms a normal subgroup.
Yeah, that's correct.
So that's why I was asking.
Yeah, that's correct. That is, all these transformations can be related to some subgroup of some continuous group. Anyway, we will discuss a little more on that later. But right now, the answer is that yes, that link is very important, and it is related to group theory. Any other questions? Okay, I wanted to, of course, tell you that this whatever discussion that we have, I have presented today, is something which is somehow not dealt very nicely in textbooks of quantum mechanics. I do not know why. Except that there was some exercise problem in modern quantum physics of J.J. Sakurai, where I think he gives two matrices, and whatever initial discussion that I had taking these matrices A and B, I think that was an exercise problem. Other than that, many people mentioned this in passing, that this is CSUO and things like that. But detailed discussion of this one and understanding of this one is somehow skipped. I do not know why. So I think you should definitely learn this so that you can understand this well. So I recommend that you can definitely read any book you want, but you don't really get much details. So what I try to present here is a comprehensive, and in fact, I was very happy about this presentation that I made a couple of times earlier, and we were thinking that I should write some article about this, and then of course that was still in the process of writing, but so I think this is kind of a detail which you will not get in usual book. So you can try to understand this, and then if you have some more doubts on this after going through this, you can also ask in the next class.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, we know that position basis and momentum basis are continuous. And we also know that the position operator and momentum operator are not bounded. So is there a connection between them, like it's not bounded and it's continuous? If it's bounded, then it should be discrete. Is there a connection?
I think, the boundedness is not there for many of these operators, I think. Okay. But anyway, I think it's a very subtle difference. So once again, I will recommend you can read for definitions. You can read this chapter in V. Balakrishnan's mathematical physics book. There is one chapter on Hilbert spaces, and that book gives you the definitions clearly. So that will tell you which is called bounded operator, which is called unbounded operator, which is called separable space. So I think you can look at that.
Okay, sir. And the question I was asking in the beginning of the class, that we have a field, okay.
Yeah, so the point is that
the vector space is a very general name, and the vector space means the elements of the set are called vectors. Whatever set that you are considering, if the element of that set is called a vector. For example, if you consider a set of all 2x2 matrices, that is a vector space. But there, the every vector is a 2x2 matrix. If you take set of all n x n matrices, every vector is a n x n matrix. If you take set of all polynomials, every polynomial is a vector. In that sense, when you take a set of all complex numbers, every complex number is a vector. When you take a set of all real numbers, every real number is a vector. Now, the set that you are considering with operations of vector addition and scalar multiplication, if that is forming a vector space or not, that means whether it is satisfying all the axioms of the vector space or not, that is what is important. If once all the axioms are satisfied, it qualifies to be a vector space. Now, whatever are the elements of the set that becomes a vector space, we call them vectors, that's all, because of the name vector space. And that has got nothing to do with the vector and scalar. The scalar and vector are associated with certain transformation properties upon rotation. But these elements of vector space are just the names, called vectors, that's all.
Sir, actually, we call a field of scalars.
Correct.
And the vector space is defined over a field of scalars.
Correct.
So, like, if C is defined over a field of C, then which is a scalar and which is a vector?
In that case, the vector and scalar are same. Because when you are saying C is defined over C, it is a one-dimensional vector space, correct?
Yes, sir.
So the scalar is
I think it's infinite dimensional. Like if we consider R over Q, then I read that it's infinite dimensional vector space. I haven't read the proof, but...
Okay, R over Q is a different question, but when you take C over R, it is two-dimensional vector space. And when you take C over C, it is one-dimensional vector space.
Okay.
R over Q is a little tricky thing that we will not go into that now. But C over C is one-dimensional. C over R is two-dimensional.
So why so, sir? Why the basis is different? Like because the cardinality of the basis set is different?
It's different because... See, one way to understand the cardinality of basis is like this. For example, if you say that, let's say you have a three-dimensional vector space. Okay. Now you can ask a question, how many components are required to define an arbitrary vector? Okay. You require three components. Each component is taken from a field, right? So you require three real numbers or three complex numbers to define a vector. So that is the cardinality of the basis. Now, when you say that, because every basis element has to be multiplied with one variable from the field, that is why how many variables are there from the field that makes up one vector. That's what I'm calling it. Now, suppose you take complex numbers over complex field to represent a complex number. How many complex numbers are required? Only one complex number is required.
Yes, sir.
But if you want to represent a complex number, how many real numbers are required? You require two real numbers.
Yes, yes. X plus I one.
Yeah. So that is why it is two-dimensional.
Okay, sir. Thank you. I think the scalar name came from the scaling property that has the scalar multiplication in vectors.
Which one? Scalar?
The name scalars, the field of scalars came from the scaling property of scalar multiplication. Like it scales a vector, like alpha scales a vector to alpha v.
Yeah, yeah.
But that is, is that different with the scale property of scalars that is invariant under the coordinate transformation? Is that different?
Yes. Yeah, yeah. That is different because definition of scalar, vector, tensor, this is a proper definition. Okay, that is related to coordinate transformation, rotations, etc. So here just a field, mathematically you call it a field. Field is the field of scalars is only our our usage itself. It's just a field. Field means it's set up. The mathematics doesn't call it scalars. We say field of scalars because we have vectors and vector space defined over the field. That's all.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So I think if there are no questions, then it's already 10. So we can ask him. Can we close?
Hello, sir. Yeah.